Hey guys, I am Venkat. In this video and in our upcoming videos in this series, we'll discuss how to create a real-world Blazor WebAssembly application from scratch. We'll be using Visual Studio 2019 and .NET 5. Fire up Visual Studio 2019, click on Create a New Project. On this screen, search for Blazor. As you can see from the search results, we have two Blazor templates. As the names imply, Blazor Server App template creates a Blazor Server project and it runs on the server. Blazor WebAssembly App template creates a Blazor WebAssembly project and it runs in the client browser. We discussed the differences between Blazor Server and Blazor WebAssembly in detail in this video. I'll include the link in the description of this video. In our case, we want to create a Blazor WebAssembly app, so let's select this template and then click Next. Provide a name for the project. I'm going to name it Blazor Project. A location where you want this project to be created. Let's create it in C:Projects folder. And a name for the solution. Let's name the solution Blazor WebAssembly Tutorial and then click Next. Target framework. We have two choices. .NET Core 3.1, .NET 5. .NET 5 is the latest, so let's select that. And as far as authentication type is concerned, for now, let's select none. And I'm going to check all these three checkboxes. Configure for HTTPS, ASP.NET Core hosted, and progressive web application. We discussed what is a progressive web app in detail in this video. If you want to check it out, I will include the link in the description of this video. What does this checkbox, ASP.NET Core hosted, do? Well, three projects are created when this checkbox is checked. Your project name, .server, .client, and .shared. Actually, let's see this in action. In Visual Studio, with all the three checkboxes checked, let's click on this Create button. There we go. We have three projects created. BlazorProject.client, BlazorProject.server, and BlazorProject.shared. The server project, that is the project with .server in its name, hosts the Blazor client project. The Blazor client project runs directly in the client browser. So when the first request is made, everything the application needs, that is the compiled application, its dependencies, and the .NET runtime are downloaded to the client browser from the server where it is hosted. The server that hosts the Blazor client application doesn't necessarily have to be an ASP.NET Core server. You can host it on any server. With the ASP.NET Core hosted checkbox checked, we get a server project that hosts the Blazor client project, and that's what exactly happened now. If we do not check this checkbox, we get only one project and we can host our Blazor WebAssembly project on any server of our choice. Actually, let's quickly see this in action. I have another brand new instance of Visual Studio 2019 running. Let's create a new project. We want to create a Blazor WebAssembly project. So let's search for Blazor, select Blazor WebAssembly app, and then click Next. Provide a name for the project. Let's call this Blazor WASM. And we want to create it in C Projects folder. And the solution name is also Blazor WASM. And let's click Next. Target framework, .NET 5. Authentication type, none. We're going to leave ASP.NET Core hosted checkbox unchecked and then let's click Create. There we go. Our project is created and notice in the Solution Explorer, we now have only one project and that is our Blazor WebAssembly project. We don't have that ASP.NET Core server project. As a matter of fact, we don't necessarily have to always host Blazor WebAssembly project in an ASP.NET Core server. We can host it in any server of our choice. The only difference is when we check the checkbox ASP.NET Core hosted, we get an ASP.NET Core server project using which we can host our Blazor WebAssembly project. Now, in our case, we're going to use ASP.NET Core server to host our Blazor WebAssembly project. So we're going to use this solution that we have created with ASP.NET Core hosted checkbox checked. Now, we also have a third project with .shared in its name. As the name implies, it contains resources that are shared by both client and server projects. If we expand the dependencies folder and take a look at the project dependencies, notice this client project has a dependency on the shared project. Similarly, if we take a look at the dependencies of the server project, it also has a dependency on the shared project. Now, As we progress through this course, we'll be building employee management system that allows us to create, read, update, and delete employees. And for that, the following are the three model classes we need. Gender, actually, gender is an enum, not a class. And then these two classes, department and employee. In the interest of time, I've already created these three model classes in the shared project. Notice we have our department, employee, and gender. So if you want to follow along and need the code for these three models, I'll have it available on my blog and include the link in the description of this video. Now, here's what we want to do. Display a list of employees using data grid component. The grid that we are using here is SyncFusion grid component. It is very powerful and offers several features like adaptive UI, touch support, globalization and localization, sorting, paging, filtering, supports all the CRUD operations, aggregated column values, export to Excel, PDF, and CSV. We'll discuss implementing some of these features in our upcoming videos. Now, if you're wondering why should we use SyncFusion Blazor components, well, there are over 70 plus components and all these work with both Blazor server and client-side projects seamlessly. Every component is fine-tuned to work with a high volume of data, so performance should not be an issue. Very good documentation and unlimited dedicated support from SyncFusion. You'll be amazed by the power and functionality these components bring to your Blazor apps. They are very easy to integrate, configure, and use. Each SyncFusion Blazor component is available as a separate NuGet package. In our case, we want to use the SyncFusion grid component. So in the Solution Explorer, right-click on the Blazor client project and select this option, Manage NuGet Packages. Make sure you're on the Browse tab and then search for syncfusion.blazor.grid. Select the first option and then click Install. As you can see, this package has a dependency on several other packages. All these dependencies will also be automatically installed. So click OK. I accept. There we go. The grid component is successfully installed. Next, for styling, we need to reference SyncFusion bootstrap theme file in index.html file. And index.html file is in this www.root folder. So let's open that. And in the head section, let's include a reference to SyncFusion bootstrap theme file. Next, we need to include two using declarations in this imports.razor file. SyncFusion.blazor and SyncFusion.blazor.grids. And finally, we need to register SyncFusion Blazor service. And in a Blazor WebAssembly project, we do that in this program.cs file. So let's open it. Just one line of code here, builder.services.addSyncFusionBlazor. We have a red squiggly, and that's because we are missing a namespace, SyncFusion.blazor. Let's bring that in by pressing Control Period. With all these changes so far, let's run our solution by pressing Ctrl F5. There we go. Our app is up and running. At the moment, we are at the root application URL and we are looking at index razor component. When I click on counter, the URL changes to slash counter and we are looking at the counter component. Similarly, when we click on fetch data, again, the URL changes to fetch data and we see the fetch data component. If you're wondering, where are all these components coming from? Well, they're coming from the pages folder. So if we take a look at this pages folder, notice we have our three components here, index, fetch data, and counter. At the moment, the index component displays this hello world message. Instead, let's use the SyncFusion grid component and display list of employees. So from the pages folder, open index.razor. We want to write some C# code in this component, so for that, let's include @code block. Let me paste a private function here. The code inside this function is very straightforward. This function is called loadData, and it is returning us list of employee objects. So what we are doing inside this function is creating four different employee objects. Finally, we are creating a list of employee objects, adding those four employee objects to this list and returning the list. In a bit, we'll see how we're going to make use of this function. At the moment, we have a lot of compilation errors and all of them are because we're missing the namespace in which this employee class is present. If you remember, this employee model class is present in this project, blazorproject.shared. So let's bring in that namespace. Now, this file index.raza is a Blazor component, and every Blazor component has a lifecycle method called onInitialized. Notice what happens when I type override and then press the spacebar. We see all the methods that we can override. I want to override onInitialized. As the name implies, this method is automatically executed when the component is completely loaded and initialized. In Blazor, we usually use this onInitialized method to load the data our component needs. And to hold on to the data, we need a public property in this component. So let's create that public property first. As you can see, we are calling this property employees, and we are going to initialize this employees property with the data this private load data method returns. Next, let's display the list of employees we have in this employees property using the SyncFusion grid component. The grid component is in this namespace, syncfusion.blazor.grids. We don't need all this HTML here, so let's delete that and include SyncFusion grid component. And the tag for that is sfgrid. SF, by the way, stands for SyncFusion. Obviously, we need to specify the data source, and for that, we use data source property. And remember, our list of employees are present in this employees property. And to reference this property, we use at and then the name of the property. Now, if we take a look at this employee class, we have got several properties here. Now, I don't want to display all these properties. I only want to display selected property values. And for that, inside this grid, we use grid columns. In here, we specify the list of properties we want to display. In our case, we are displaying four properties: employee ID, first name, last name, and email. We are also specifying custom header text. With all these changes in place, let's run our project by pressing Ctrl F5. There we go. We have our list of employees displayed as expected, but we have this big red license validation message. Obviously, to fix this, we have to include a valid license key. And we do that in the main method of this program.cs file. So let's open that. And in the main method here, all we need is this one line of code. We need a valid license key. If you want to just try SyncFusion components, you can use their trial version. You can also use their community license. All the SyncFusion components are free to use with their community license. To qualify for the community license, you should meet two conditions. Your annual gross revenue must be less than $1 million and must not have more than 5 developers. I already have a community license, and to get the license key, navigate to this URL, syncfusion.com/account/downloads, and then click on this button, get license key. Here, select the platform. I'm actually going to select all and then click get license key. We see the license key here. Let me copy it to clipboard and then paste it right here. There we go. We no longer have the license validation message. This SyncFusion grid component is very powerful, and it offers several features like sorting, paging, filtering, supports all the CRUD operations, aggregated column values, export to Excel, PDF, and CSV. We'll discuss implementing some of these features in our upcoming videos. That's it in this video. Thank you for listening.